Now, there's another explanation. Verse 18 of this same chapter. The Lord is righteous, for I've rebelled against His commandment. Here I pray you, all people, and behold my sorrow. My virgins and my young men are gone into captivity. This man Jeremiah, he alone is the only mourner at the destruction of Jerusalem, and the debris is there. The city lies in ashes, and this man, he's weeping. What's the explanation? That city's sin. And the second thing is, the Lord is righteous. God did it, and God was right in what He did. And that's difficult to understand. And I want to come back to that tremendous statement that we made. And friends, may I say again, I feel totally inadequate to deal with this. I merely stand at the fringe of the sorrow of this man and find I cannot enter in. I can merely look over the wall into his garden, and that's all. I'm not able to walk up and down in it. And may I say to you that he's revealed two things here, the bitter and the sweet. He has revealed the fact that Jerusalem is sinned and that God loves Jerusalem. And will you listen to him here? Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by? Behold and see if there's any sorrow like unto my sorrow, which is done unto me, wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger. And as we said before, people don't like to hear about the fierce anger of God today. That's left out. Even today, I find in many places. And I have time now as a retired preacher to look at TV, and I have been watching to see what's going on. I hadn't listened or looked for years, and I'll be honest with you, I didn't know that we'd gone as far as we had gone. Now, I saw several Christmas programs put on by churches on TV. And may I say to you, now I will sound like a squire, because I am a squire, and I'm a retired preacher, and somebody will say, well, he's beginning to get senile. Maybe I am. But I do want to say this. The church is sure getting away from the Word of God today. Even those so-called gospel churches, I listen to them singing songs, and I must confess, the songs I hadn't heard before. Though there was one or two of the Christmas carols put in, and it had a little religious flavor. It had, as someone has said in one of these messages, he said, this is the essence of the gospel. Well, I remember what a professor of mine said what the essence is. The essence is the odor that's left in the bottle after the liquid is gone. And the water of life was not there. And it was a travesty of the gospel because they did say that he was born of a virgin. I rejoiced in that. That he was God manifest in the flesh. But they said that he can give you personality and bring peace and he can bring love. And it was, oh, it was so sweet and ducky and lovey. And may I say, I came to the conclusion that everything there was for comfort and everything was compromise. Oh, they can say today, oh, we're trying to reach the lost world. Jeremiah did too, and he wasn't very successful, but he at least gave God's message. May I say to you today that it's so easy to stand on the sidelines, maybe like I am, and say what I'm saying right now, but maybe somebody needs to say it as we're saying it today. Jerusalem hath grievously sinned, and the Lord is righteous. God loved them, he said, with an everlasting love. And he brought this upon them because he's righteous. And I'd like to read you now the statement of another that might help us to understand this. He can say it so much better than I can. And I'm quoting now from Dr. G. Campbell Morgan. Will you listen to this? He says, there is the need for the revelation of God's anger. And I'm reading now, this is a supreme necessity in the interest of the universe. Prisons are in the interest of the free. Hell is the safeguard of heaven. A state that cannot punish crime is doomed, and a God who tolerates evil is not good. Deny me my biblical revelation of the anger of God, and I am insecure in the universe. But reveal to me this throne established, occupied by one whose heart is full of tenderness, whose bowels yearn with love, then am I assured that he'll not tolerate that which blights and blasts and damns, but will destroy it and all its instruments in the interests of that which is high and noble and pure. Oh, my friend, you and I are living in a universe where there is a God, a living God, a God whose heart goes out in love and he yearns over you. But I want to say this to you. You can turn your back on him and he'll judge you and he'll still love you because he's the God of this universe. And I'm not sure I understand all that, but I know that's what he says in his word. And someday he's going to make it clear that hell is actually there because he is a God of love and a God of righteousness and a God of holiness. And the whole universe, including Satan himself, will have to admit that God is righteous and just in all that he does. My friend, God is so great and wonderful and good that we dare not trifle with him. He could say to those scribes and Pharisees, even the religious leaders of his day, he says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites!" And why? Well, because of the fact ye devour widows' houses. That's one of the things. May I say to you, if you can't take Christianity into your home, as well as your heart, into your business, into your social life, may I say to you, he'll have to say to you what he said to those religious rulers. You're a hypocrite. I didn't say it. He said it, my beloved. And he's the one that wept over these men, and he had tears in his eyes. My eyes are dry, but his eyes are filled with tears for you and for me today. Oh, my friend, don't turn your back on a God that loves you like this. It'll be tragic indeed if you do. And then our God is a righteous God and a holy God. Now, what God did, he did because God is righteous. He can't shut his eyes to evil. And even when his own children disobey him, God must discipline them. He must move in, and though it may break his heart, and actually, as we've seen, Jeremiah reveal the heart of God. And when he weeps, God's weeping. And when he sorrows, God is sorrowing. And he may not have all the answers, as we don't have all today, but he does reveal the heart of God. But the important thing is to trust in knowing that what God is doing, God's righteous in what he does. And friends, that's mighty hard to take, as we shall see in this book. And that he was right in letting Jerusalem be destroyed and the people go into captivity. It broke God's heart, and this man Jeremiah reveals it. I'd like to pass on to you Smith's little poem on Jerusalem that I feel probably gives a penetration into the life of this man, Jeremiah. And I'm reading the poem now. "I am the man sore smitten with the wrath of him who fashioned me. My heart is faint and crieth out, spare, spare, O God, thy saint. But yet with darkness doth he hedge my path. My eyes with streams of fiery tears run down to see the daughter of my people slain, and in Jerusalem the godless reign. Trouble, trouble are upon me thrown. Mine adversaries clap their sinful hands the while they hiss and wag their heads and say, where is the temple but of yesterday? The noblest city of 100 lands. We do confess our guilt. Then, Lord, arise, avenge us of our enemies. Well, that's the poem. And this man, Jeremiah, is the man who cried out. He wanted to know why. And many of us have done the same thing. God now lets him see that the thing that he's doing is actually right. That is what God's doing. The question, though, arises, how much are the people involved? Does the world really care? And the question he asks here, is it nothing to you that pass by? And today it's difficult for man to accept the fact that God is angry. We're living in a day when this matter that God is love has certainly been played for all it's worth. And I agree with it. God is love. And God loves you. And I don't care who you are, what you've done. God loves you. You can't keep him from loving you any more than you can keep the sun from shining. You could get out of the love of God as you can get out of sunshine, but God loves you. And it's certainly needed to be emphasized because the church has not taken the love of God into the marketplace. And that's where it should be. It hasn't quite made it there yet. But may I say this to you? There did come along a generation that put an overemphasis on love, and it is sure that they did that. We've seen it on bumper stickers, and we've heard it everywhere. But they at least have called attention to the love of God in our day. Well, maybe it's that we're coming along now to call attention to the fact that God is righteous, and that God is holy, and God is just in what he does. Now the fact remains, how much do we really care and feel about all this? Is it nothing to you that Jeremiah sat there weeping over the city? There were not many others weeping over it. Oh, I know the captives who had been taken down to Babylon. They were by the canals of Babylon. And we're told in Psalm 137, they sat down and they wept when they remembered Zion. But you feel that their weeping and their repentance even then was not from the heart. They felt that God had not been quite right in what he had done. He had no right to let them go into captivity. Weren't they his chosen people? And they cry out for vengeance at that time. And I think they had a perfect right to do that. But how much real feeling was there? It was the kind of repentance that the thief has who was caught. He began to repent. He didn't repent that he was a thief. He repented because he'd been caught. And he was sorry that they found him out. These people now are carried into captivity. And they're prepared now to weep. They've lost everything. Jeremiah was not carried into captivity. And he can sit there by the debris with all of the wreckage, all of the ashes and the ruins of that city, and he weeps. He's a free man, but they're not. But it's something that had moved him, and he was involved, and he was concerned. And I come back to the thing I mentioned before, that I have watched many of these TV programs, and especially at Christmas time. And I do want to say that they were very well done. They were finished programs, a thing of beauty. They had polish. They were professional. There were so many good things that you could say about them. It was a credit to the church to do something that would compare to the professionalism of the world. You have to commend them for that. But the one word that I did not hear and do not hear today, oh, I think it probably got in one of the Christmas carols last Christmas, but they didn't emphasize the word sin. Great deal about the love of God, but nothing about the fact that we are sinners and that God is righteous and that God has to punish sin. They didn't emphasize that at all. May I say to you that we can talk about the virgin birth of Christ, we can talk about the deity of Christ, you can even talk about the death of Christ and the resurrection of Christ, but my friend, the question is, why did he die? Why is he dying on a cross? Let me add that the question that is raised back in the 22nd Psalm, there's where you find it first, and the question there is, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And our Lord gave that when he was hanging on the cross, and the answer isn't in the Gospels, but the answer's back in the 22nd Psalm, because thou art holy. He's a holy God. He's righteous. And Christ is dying on that cross because you and I are sinners, because you and I are hell-doomed sinners. Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by in this day? Look at that cross. He's dying. He didn't have to die. He's suffering as no man has had to suffer. God has forsaken him, and God will never forsake you as long as you're alive. And he forsook Christ so that he would not have to forsake you. Now, may I say, is it nothing to you? McChaney, who had an experience with the Lord, he's put it in a very wonderful way. And McChaney was a very wonderful man of God in past days. Listen to this. I'm reading now. I oft read with pleasure to soothe or engage Isaiah's wild measure, are John's simple faith, but e'en when they picture the blood-sprinkled tree, Jehovah Sid Canoe was nothing to me. Let me pause to say that Jehovah Sid Canoe means Jehovah, our righteousness. Now let me continue the point. Like tears from the daughters of Zion roll, I wept when the waters went over his soul, yet thought not that my sin had nailed to the tree, Jehovah Sid Canoe, 'twas nothing to me. Is it nothing to you that pass by? When free grace awoke me, my light from on high, then legal fear shook me. I trembled to die. No refuge, no safety in self could I see. Jehovah Sid Canoe, my Savior must be. My terrors all vanished before that sweet name. My guilty fears vanished with boldness. I came to drink at the fountain, life-giving and free. Jehovah Sid Canoe is all things to me. My friend, is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by? Have you come to Jesus just to give you a little personality to join the church? You want to be a little religious, to bring a little peace into your soul and to create a little love on your altar? Is that the reason he died on the cross? Will you hear me? My friend, he died on the cross to save you from hell. That's the reason he died for you. The Holy Spirit has come into the world to reveal Christ as a Savior. And one of the reasons that he's come to convict the world of sin, what kind of sin? Murder? Thievery? Oh, yes, I think he does, but that's not what it says. I think that is true, but the Word of God goes deeper. It's something worse than that. They sin because they believe not on him. What's the worst sin in this world? Well, God has a remedy for the murderer. The thief on the cross was a murderer. He got saved. Paul, I think, is guilty of murder. I think he's responsible for the death of Stephen. He got saved. Moses, I say to you that God has a remedy for a murder. God has a remedy for a thief. God has a remedy for a liar. And God has a remedy for a homosexual, too. But God doesn't even have a remedy for the man who rejects Jesus Christ, because they believe not on me. That's the sin. And I would say that's the greatest sin that you can commit. Of course, it's a state rather than an act, because I don't think you can ever commit the act of rejecting Christ. I think you can gradually get to the state where it's absolutely meaningless. And I think that there are those who have reached that place. We've seen the Jerusalem in the book of Jeremiah reach the place where God could say to this man, Jeremiah, don't be disturbed that they're not listening to you. Why, he said, if I don't answer your prayer, why, if Moses were here and Elijah were here and Samuel were here, I wouldn't hear their prayer either. I think he could have called up all the Old Testament saints and said, they were all here, it's too late, they've crossed over. And I'm of the opinion that this sophisticated and very chic age in which we're living today, that thinks it knows everything, that there are many that have crossed over. Now, I must confess, I've seen the conversion of some folk that I never thought could be saved. I've met several folk who have been saved through this radio ministry, that had I met them before they were saved, I'm sure I would have said they were hopeless cases. One man up in San Francisco Bay Area, on drugs, a hippie of the hippies, he committed several crimes. He's guilty, and apparently is guilty of the death of two people in an accident. But this man got marvelously, wonderfully saved. So I'm not the one to say when you've stepped over, but somewhere along the line, you can step over, and that's the thing that happened to this city. It had happened to an individual. What does Jesus Christ, his death, mean to you today? I read the testimony of a man who's written a book telling how God made him rich and all that sort of thing. But it was all about I. And I can't find where he says anything about how much the Lord Jesus means to him. My friend, what does he mean to you? Is it nothing to you that